हेलो सर, गुड इवनिंग एचिदास सर, कैन वी स्टार्ट द इवेंट?
कैन स्टार्ट।
ओके सर। अ वेरी गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल द डिग्निटरीज, गेस्ट, डेलीगेट्स एंड आवर बिलव्ड स्टूडेंट्स। Welcome to our yet another session of guest speaker series. I feel heartily privileged to have with us this evening Dr. Malay Kumar Pradhan to motivate and cherish the young minds of NIT Meghalaya. Dr. Malay Kumar Pradhan is presently the General Manager, FNB, ODMA, Government of Odisha, and in charge of the State Chemical Disaster Management Cell. He is also the Vice Chairman of National Safety Council, Odisha Chapter. He graduated in mechanical engineering from CET BBSR Engineering College. He also did his master's in heat power engineering from UC Birla Engineering College. He has also been awarded the PhD degree in safety, health and environment from Sambalpur University. Now, I would kindly request Mr. Dr. Malay Kumar Pradhan sir to share his knowledge and all of his beautiful experiences with us. Please, sir.
Okay, good evening, everybody. I hope I am audible to everybody.
Yes, sir, you are.
Yeah.
Yes, sir, you are.
Yeah, you are audible.
So I am thankful to the National Institute, NIT Meghalaya, for giving me an opportunity to share my thoughts about the disasters particularly restricted to chemical accidents which are going to take place in any part of our country, and how I will discuss that how Odisha State Disaster Management Authority, who is definitely pioneer with respect to the natural disaster is concerned, is now equipped with all facilities to deal with the chemical emergency situations arising out of many places, etc. Now I want to share my screen. So can I share now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
But how to share? Just 1 minute, please.
Sir, please unmute, sir.
Sir, you are muted.
Sir, please unmute yourself.
So, whether my screen is visible?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Visible. Okay. Thank you. Thank you. So just I want to tell you, if you look into the chemical accidents, there is a term called CBRN, chemical, biological, radiological, and nuclear accidents, which are otherwise known as the man-made disasters. So if it is related to any chemicals, because of the presence of chemical, if there is some accident, it is coming under chemical disaster category. Because of some biological, just like now COVID is a biological disaster, maybe some radiological, suppose there are some radiography is going on in industries also or in any hospital, etc. There is, suppose there is leakage of any radioactive material, it can lead to a radiological problem, and even nuclear. Now suppose there are certain nuclear centers like Chandipur in Odisha or any other centers, if there is any problem, it may lead to nuclear problem. Now coming to the overall figure, this is what is the statistics I have gathered from International Labor Organization, that around 340 million accidents at work that take place every year. And out of that, from that, around 160 million occupational diseases that take place because of the occupation of a person. Now, what are the occupational diseases? Maybe silicosis is an occupational disease. Any manufacturing process where silica as a free dust is available in the working environment, it can enter into the respiratory system of a person. Because of inhalation of that silica dust, it gets deposited in the lungs of a person, and ultimately he is suffered from a disease that is called silicosis, which is almost of the same symptoms of tuberculosis, but it is because of the silica dust, and it is an irreversible disease. So slowly and slowly, once a person is affected by it, there is no medicine available in the world which can again regain, or he can recover from the disease. Even a noise-induced hearing loss, if a person is exposed to the work environment, lot of noise. So in the process of time, what will happen, a particular decibel of sound will not be audible to the person. So it is again a irreversible problem. So if the noise is little less, or if it is more, then only the person can hear. Otherwise, he cannot hear anything. So all these are called the occupational disease. My screen is moving?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, thank
you. So now coming to the SAM, the around more than 2.8 million deaths that take place in the work environment. I am just coming back to again, there are around 340 million accidents at work, plus 150, 60 million occupational diseases. Total is around 500 million. And out of that, the death rate is 2.8 million. So it is almost, you can say around 0.5% of the cases, now death occurs. So it is caused by the accidents at work or work-related health conditions every year. So if you come to the statistics, so you can only know that in every 15 seconds, someone dies due to work conditions. And annually, the economic loss worldwide is around $3 trillion, which is coming to around 4% of the economic losses annually worldwide. And if you look into the things, the fatal injuries due to fall, a person while working at height, he fell down, and because of that, he meets with an accident, and the fatality rate out of the total, that 2.8 million fatality, out of that 20% is related to fall from height. And it is around $0.6 trillion is the economical loss worldwide. And fatality rate in India is almost double that of advanced industrialized economies like USA and UK. This is a very important thing. If you look into 1960 statistics given by the employee state insurance, it was 6 times. Gradually we are improving. And now this is the 2020 statistics that the fatality rate is double than US and UK. Even although we are improving with regards to safety standard is concerned, but still it is more than the most advanced countries. We will definitely discuss that how we can mitigate. Now, 60% of world's labor force is ineffectively protected against work-related accidents and illness. I repeat, ineffectively protected. Ineffectively protected and effectively protected are two different things. Suppose somebody is given a helmet while working on the shop floor. Suppose he did not put on the helmet in the proper manner. Means there is a chin strap. If the students have seen the helmet, a helmet has got lot of features. Number one is a chin strap, which is just put on the chin so that the helmet will not fall down. But many times what people do or the workers do, they put on the helmet on the head, but they don't give the chin strap. So what will happen when the person will fall down, automatically the helmet will go out of his head. So if you use the helmet just like a hat, then we will tell it is ineffectively used. So it is ineffectively protected. And the very basic reason of ineffectively protection is lack of knowledge. If the person will be given adequate knowledge, the very basic intention of putting your helmet is to save your head. And it must be used in a proper manner. And if the manner is not being done perfectly, definitely it will again lead to problem, even if somebody is using a helmet. Now, the chemical disasters are nothing but is an unintentional release of one or more hazardous substances which could harm human health and environment. So here I am giving emphasis on unintentional release. You don't intend it to release, but it automatically gets released. In certain chemicals, we generally release it, which is intentional. So all safety precautions are being taken. But if it is released unintentionally, we don't desire it, but it got released. That is unintentional release that will lead to chemical disaster. And number two, it must be the hazardous substances. The release must be a hazardous substance, maybe a gas, maybe a liquid, or maybe a solid having hazardous nature, and which could harm. Harm means which has got a potential to cause danger or injury to a person. It's called harm to human health and environment. So all these things will lead to chemical disaster. One of the best example is the methyl isocyanate gas leakage in Bhopal. So chemical hazards are the systems where chemical accidents could occur under certain circumstances. Now the question is, we being the engineering graduates, why we are reading something like this? That is a very important question. The point is, we want to discuss certain things which are not every day taught in our regular classes. But the day you will become an engineer, then ultimately many of you will definitely come to the shop floor. And while dealing in an engineering firm, you will be exposed to a lot of chemicals. Unless otherwise you know the hazard associated with a chemical, what are the safe means to do it, what are the precautions you are going to take it, then definitely it will lead to problem. So it is always better, a planning will definitely make you perfect. So that's why we are taking a step that how the young engineers can have a little input on the various hazardous chemicals so that they can work safely in their future endeavor. Now, a chemical accident. What is the meaning of a chemical accident? A chemical accident means an accident involving a fortuitous or sudden or unintended occurrence while handling any hazardous chemical, resulting in continuous, intermittent, or repeated exposure to death or injury to any person or damage to any property, but does not include an accident by reason only of war or radioactivity. So what it wants to tell you, that it is a fortuitous, means it may happen, unintended occurrence which can cause property damage, any injury, death to the person. Now, where there is chance of chemical accidents? Chemical accidents can originate in manufacturing or formulation facility. Manufacturing facility means, suppose a fertilizer plant. So they use certain chemicals. Suppose a paint factory, suppose a cement factory. So all these factories, they use chemicals. So the chemical are being used in the process, or even they manufacture chemicals. Suppose a chlorine manufacturing company, suppose a ammonia manufacturing company. So they use certain raw materials and their finished product is chlorine. And chlorine is nothing but a bleaching agent. It is used in paper mills. It is used for pulling paper like this. So when anybody is manufacturing in a factory, there is a chance of chemical accident. Or formulation facility. Formulation facility means one or more chemicals, they are now grouped together. Suppose we want to develop a chemical where we use more than one chemical with a proper composition. And then a new product is, we get it. So that is called formulation. So where the chemicals are being manufactured or formulated, there is chance of chemical accident. During the process operation at any stage of the product cycle, any stage of the product cycle means starting from raw material to intermediate product, in the process, in the pipeline, or in handling. So anywhere in the product cycle, till the finished product is received and it is being stored or well packed. So in each and every point, because the hazardous chemicals are being used, so there is a chance of chemical accidents. Material handling, many times chemicals like acids, chemicals like your oxygen cylinders, or even the LPG cylinders like this, or you are having the propane in a bullets or hot and spears fixed size. So all these things where it is being handled, then transportation and storage of HazChem, means hazardous chemical. You must have seen while you are going on the national highway, there are a lot of tankers through which LPG, propane, ammonia, chlorine, these are being transported on road. And many times you will find that it passes through the busy locality. So now you think of in a very busy locality, suppose a ammonia carrying tanker, there is a leakage. So what will happen? People will be under panic because you cannot rescue people at this stage because of this thing. So unless otherwise adequate planning is made, so it will become a disaster. So that is the even storage in many places. Suppose the LPG cylinder that you are getting in your home. So that is being refilled, that is being filled up in a plant where we store huge quantity of LPG in the shape of bullets or hot and spears. Now suppose a catastrophic failure is there and now LPG started leaking. There is chance of blabby, there is chance of explosion. All these things can happen. And the vulnerability means the intensity of the damage is sometimes compounded due to the location of major accident hazard industries close to densely populated areas. If you look into the pollution control board norms, then no hazardous industries should come up within half a kilometer or 1 kilometer of the locality of the people. But once a chemical industry is set up, now locality comes closer to the factory. The Rourkela steel plant with German technology, when it was set up, so at that time the area was absolutely in the forest areas or in the hills, everywhere there was no population, nothing. But now it has become densely populated. Now if any chemical gets released from the factory, definitely the people who are going to be affected, it is because of the dense population. Now what is a chemical accident? This chemical accident can lead to the following things. One is a fire. Suppose LPG is a chemical. If it leaks, then it can immediately, if there is a spark or some ignition item is available, then it will immediately cause fire. So it can also cause explosion. Explosion is nothing but a delayed fire is an explosion. Just like in our home, in the LPG burner, if you just open the burner, but you are not able to get your, suppose the lighter or your to fire it. So some amount of LPG will come out. When you give the spark, then it immediately gives a pop sound and it causes a fire. So that is, so a delayed fire is called explosion. So if you are having huge quantity of fuel readily available, and then there is a spark, so it will always, it will try to catch fire with enormous energy will be evolving from the fire, which will lead to explosion. Then toxic release, these ammonia gas, these chlorine gas, these are toxic in nature. If you inhale, then definitely it will cause problem. If there may be carbon monoxide, then poisoning. There are few gas which say carbon monoxide poisoning. Carbon monoxide poisoning means this CO gas in the blast furnace. Suppose when we are just manufacturing iron or steel in a blast furnace, the raw material is fed into the blast furnace. In the process, we get now blast furnace gas, where there is a percentage around 33% of the gas contains CO, carbon monoxide. Now, this carbon monoxide has got a high affinity toward in the hemoglobin. So, when it is in the air, now it will immediately get attached to the hemoglobin of the blood, and what it will do? It will not allow the oxygen to enter into our blood. So, out of suffocation, people die. That is called CO poisoning. A combination of anything, there may be a fire along with explosion, there may be a toxic release along with fire. So all these things can happen. So now our point of interest is how it will happen, what are the precautionary measures we will take. And these measures can be basically broadly divided into three categories. Number one is we have to plan that there will be no fire. Number two, if there is a fire, then we have to mitigate the fire then and there, so that it will be extinguished. And number three, after the fire is over, everything is done, then what are the precautionary measures you will take? That is the evacuation, etc. So pre-disaster, during disaster, and post-disaster scenario we'll consider and we'll discuss in detail. Now, why a chemical accident will take place? So now we have to plan. So the system for our statistics or analysis, it is revealed that a chemical accident generally takes place because of the technical errors. In that, technical errors means there may be a technical error in the design, there may be a fatigue issue. Suppose repeated use of chemicals in the process without proper maintenance can lead to fatigue. So we have to, because there is a life period, just like a human being, the average, it has got an average life period. So each and every machine has got an average life period. Now, Government of India has come up with a notification that in the vehicles can be used maximum 15 years. In foreign countries, it is 10 years. So it means that after 15 years, so there is a fatigue to the different parts of the machine or the vehicle. So that is to be also addressed. So for that, you have to go for various non-destructive testings or the remnant life assessment of the different parts so that you can know. So otherwise, then you can further allow it maybe for another 2 years or 3 years or 5 years, depending on the result. Similarly, corrosion, because when it comes in contact with oxygen and there is a moisture, definitely the parts gets corroded. And once it got corroded, so the thickness will be reduced. Once thickness gets reduced, definitely it cannot withstand the pressure. So ultimately, it can lead to a technical error. So as an engineer, we must see that the design deficiency, if at all, is to be rectified. So we have to also understand that what is fatigue, and after a particular period of time, we must get it tested to see the strength of the equipment. Then the corrosion, etc. also, we should take good care so that there will be no corrosion. Many times galvanizing is done, many times paints are being given so that it will not corrode. Means we want that our material, which is likely to be corroded, should not come in contact with the moisture. So that sort of arrangement we must do. So these are the technical things. Then human errors. In many, in the factory, once you go, lot of work, although engineers are available, are being done by the shop floor workers. Shop floor workers are either unskilled in nature or semi-skilled in nature, maybe skilled in nature. If they're skilled or highly skilled, they can understand the procedure. But the other people, particularly in unskilled and semi-skilled category, whose knowledge is less, so they don't understand the procedure, and they always try to deviate the procedure. Deviate the procedure means, suppose certain things are required to be done. Now there is a SOP available, safe operation procedure. Now they try to deviate the process. They try to neglect the safety instruction. why shall we do like this? Even in our home, we find an electrician when he comes in, he always tried to neglect the safety instruction. He will try to touch it in this. He will try to do lot of, he will never switch off the main switch. He will, without use of the hand gloves, etc., he will try to do it. So there are certain, each things and everything must be done in the proper procedure to have the vision zero, means zero accident is possible. But we should not neglect or deviate the procedure. Then lack of information. In certain cases, the information is not available. A bridge is going to collapse. Now that technical information is not available with us, means we, our engineers, they don't know that what exactly we want to study, the how we want to study, so that we can come to a conclusion that this part of the bridge is getting weakened and the strength. Suppose it has, everything is designed for a particular self-operating, self-working load. Now, after the period of time, if maintenance is not okay, then definitely there will be some deterioration and the load carrying capacity of the systems will decrease. So in the process, we engineers must understand that there should be now new methodologies are there. So it is coming up, even so that from software analysis also, we can understand now that at this particular point, now it is, the strength is going to be reduced. Then organizational error, even poor emergency planning. Poor emergency planning means, now suppose there is a chance of leakage of ammonia or chlorine from the tanker. Now, even if it leaks, in spite of the best of the safety precautions we have taken, there must be system readily available in the organization so that they can immediately, now they can immediately detect the leakage and they can immediately address it and they try to plug it. So how it will be done? Now, one of the thing is that they should be having good personal protective equipment with oxygen facility. Then they must have the ammonia torch. So that will indicate that from which point there is a leakage. If leakage is there, they should have the fixture so that they will close the leakage spot with the help of some instrument. So all the things are required. And the person must be trained. And there should be mock drills regularly conducted. So if all the things are done, then we can say that they are having good emergency planning. So even if the best of the technology is being used, till then, accident is accident. Even in the worst situation, suppose something goes wrong, so your emergency planning, etc., must be also there. For that also, we have to apply our head well in advance, so that in case of emergency, we can handle it with care. It is well said that a fire, if you can control it within 5 minutes, then a bucket of water can quench it. But within first 5 minutes, suppose we fail to control a fire, even the oceans will also become insufficient. So it is always a good organizational planning or emergency planning which can give better result for the cause of human safety. So that we must also look into. And all these things, particularly when we are reading our engineering, all these things actually we never come across. Now, there are some compounding effects of the chemical accidents. How? Now, the wind speed and direction. Suppose in a factory, ammonia is being stored. Now, depending on the wind speed and direction, now the ammonia will start traveling. That's why if you look to the very chemical factories, they always give wind shock on the top of their buildings so that people can understand that this is the direction where wind is flowing. If the wind is flowing in that direction, whatever leakage of ammonia, that will also start flying in that direction. Now, suppose you move just opposite to that direction with an angle of 45 degree. So that what will happen? Now, you will not come across of the that release gas or the leakage gas and your life is safe. So that sort of instruction must come. And at the time of evacuation, suppose after dispersion modeling, dispersion modeling is a technique, that is a software through which we can understand that depending on the size of a leakage and the pressure available, the volume available, the temperature, all the things taken together, so it will give you a clear-cut picture that in case of a leakage, it can travel maybe suppose up to 1 kilometer. Now 1 kilometer in which direction? It may be around 360 degrees. But wind direction will say, no, at 30 to 35 degree or 40 degree angle, now it will start moving. So slowly, slowly, it will now deviate like this. So the people who are coming in that zone, in the zone of the wind speed, they are under vulnerable conditions. Others are safe. So now instead of attacking to all people in the periphery of the factory 360 degree, we can attack up to only a 30 degree. A small sector will come. So by little application of mind, we can now almost 11 times we reduce our risk. So our risk is now confined to 30% and up to 1 kilometer. So we know this is the now our vulnerability zone. Then rate of precipitation, toxicity, quantity of chemical release, then population in each of the release. So all these things will actually compound the chemical accidents. Even the accident is happening inside the factory, but it is going beyond the boundary and there is a dense population. So the problem is more. If suppose less population, the problem is less because we are more concerned for the human life. Now probability of formation of a lethal mixture, fuel and area. Many times, suppose a fuel is coming out and when it comes in contact with air and oxygen comes out, then definitely it will start burning. Then other industrial activities being performed in closure. That is a cascading effect is also possible. Suppose there is a leakage from one factory and it caught fire and it can immediately transfer to the nearby. In many villages, when there is a fire, now series of fire takes place. So that is a cascading effect. Similarly, also in industrial activities, now suppose there is an explosion in some factory and it will hit from the explosion, the parts will fly off and it will hit to the some other industry. In the other industry, there is another fire. So all these things problem can also take place. So that we should also look into. So this is the United Nations view. Now the United Nations General Secretary has given this verdict. The more government, UN agencies, organization, businesses, and civil society understand risk and vulnerability, the better equipped they will be to mitigate disasters when they strike and save more lives. So even the community people who are just in the vicinity of the factory, so they must also understand. I am giving one example, methyl isocyanate gas. The best remedy for the methyl isocyanate gas is to just put a wet handkerchief on your nose. So methyl isocyanate gas would have been absorbed with the water and it will not be inhaled by the people and people would have become safe. So this simple thing was not understood by the people. So that's why more and more people died. So it is the legal responsibility on the part of the management of a factory to educate the people who are staying in the vicinity of a factory that what can go wrong. So in case of a problem like this or a emergency situation, what exactly the people will do. And they should have the also regular mock drill so that even if the problem strikes, then people can behave in a very systematic and smart manner for the zero casualty. Now, this is the 7 targets. That is, there is a Sendai framework. So it was held in the year 2015. So in 15 years, by the end of 2030, so there was a global acceptance that what exactly we want to do. So it has been resolved by the entire world that substantially will reduce 4 things and will increase 3 things. So what we want to reduce? We will reduce the global disaster mortality. People will not die due to disasters or will try to reduce it. I am giving you one example. In 1999, there was a super cyclone in Odisha and more than 10,000 people died. And the similar magnitude, Fani, a cyclone Fani hit the Odisha's coast during 2020, after 21 years, and the fatality is 63. Now you tell, when during 1999 it was 10,000, in 2021, in 2020 it is only 63. It is because of effective planning how to face the emergency. This is what the intention of the Sendai framework, that we must substantially reduce the global disaster mortality and number of affected people. People will not be affected. So what we are doing, whenever there is a question of any cyclone, etc. We are giving warning to the people. And from the low-lying area, we are evacuating people to the shelter centers. So by that, less and less people will come in contact with the hazard or disaster. So definitely, less people will be affected. Economic loss in relation to GDP and damage to critical infrastructure. Now, what is happening in every coastal area, every coastal district or area, all infrastructures are made like this, that the wind speed up to 300 km can be withstood by the structures. So if it is designed accordingly, then definitely even if the cyclone strikes, so there will be no damage to the property. Then what we want to increase? The number of countries with national and local DRR, disaster risk reduction strategies by 2020. International cooperation to develop countries, developing countries, and availability and access to early warning system. Early warning system, you see, whenever there is a cyclone or like this, so what will happen? Now, the path can be described. At what speed it is coming, it is now known. So if because of this advanced warning system, so now we are able to know that this is the path through which things will travel. Similarly, a dispersion modeling is a software which is being used in the factory. From that, you can evaluate at this velocity or wind velocity, at this temperature, at this pressure, if this much quantity will be released, then how much distance it will travel and how many people will be affected. All these things can be known, and if it can be understood well in advance, definitely you can educate your people and people can be rescued. This is what the intention of this Sendai framework. Now, disasters are not natural. You see, we say the flood, cyclone are the natural disasters, and we say the chemical accidents, these are man-made. But we say these are also natural. Why? Now, 0% casualty is possible. If adequate planning, design, inspection, all the techniques are well integrated, then definitely there will be no disaster. So that's why we say, because we don't take care of all the things correctly, we overlook the safety precautions, we are not serious on the things, we are not adequate in emergency planning, that's why these disasters take place. So to understand a disaster's risk, one is hazard, then exposure, then vulnerability. So all these things we have to go in little detail. Now, these are the concept of disaster management. You will be happy to know, till 2015, our system of disaster management was reactive. Whenever there is a cyclone, we are always the district administration or government. We are now geared up to address the 4 R. One is rescue. The people will be affected and we will rescue them. And we will recovery. And we will give them relief. And we will rehabilitate them. So there will be damage, we will rehabilitate. So there will be problem, we will give them food, water, etc., relief. And we will try to recover the whatever damage is there, etc., we'll do. So this was the earlier concept, which is called a reactive concept. Means once there is action, then reaction. But now, after 2015, after the Sendai framework came into picture, now the government initiative worldwide is proactive. Proactive means we have to plan, we have to prevent, we have to be prepared, then we have to respond. We must plan for an emergency. The emergency may strike at this stage. If so, what exactly? Why it will strike? So what precautions we will take so that it will not strike? If suppose it strikes, then how will we prevent it? In many times, a person is falling from a height. So we must plan that he will not fall from the height. How? Now we can give him a good platform. We can give them a good barrication so that the person will not fall. Now suppose even if we are giving the barrication failed and the person will now falling. How can we prevent? A person, even if falls, he is not going to die. He will die or he will meet with an accident only when he is hit on the ground or hit on a structure. I repeat again, a person while working at height, if he fell down, he is not going to meet with an accident. We will only meet with an accident when he will hit on the ground or hit on a structure. So prevention means, prevention says, even if a person is falling from a height, don't allow him to hit on the ground. You prevent him by giving a suppose safety net. Just in the circus, people are jumping from the top, but they are falling on a net or screen, and they are happy. There is no problem. So this is prevention. Then preparedness. Suppose even if there is some problem, then how quickly you address. Now what happens in an accident? Suppose in a factory happens, so the person is now rushed to the hospital. So that time itself, taking around half a minute, half an hour or 1 hour, which is the golden moment. So by that time, once the patient reaches the hospital, so he is half dead. Now it becomes very difficult to again recover the vital parts of the body. Now suppose we are well prepared. All sort of precautionary measures in the factories, etc., are available. So these emergency medical help can be extended to the person at site. So within at the earliest possible time. Then what will happen? Now we utilize the golden hours. So definitely it becomes easy for the people to get survived. Then response. So what is coming in the planning stage? As I have already told you, being an engineer, I have gone little technical in nature. The while planning, we must understand if you are setting up any industry, we must have the records worldwide. That what are the problems associated there? So why there was a failure? What improvement they have done? Accordingly, your product selection, process selection, site selection, all these things will be there. Why I am telling you site selection? If it is a chemical factory, the site selection is very important. It is not at all worth to allow a chemical industry to come in a busy locality. So it must be well segregated to one of the part. And there should be, so like the site selection process, even process, why I am telling you, now suppose in a power plant, chlorine is being used to cool. For cooling purpose, it has got some hazardous in nature because it is toxic. Whenever there is a leakage of chlorine, it will lead to fatality. So what is the process? So in place of chlorine, you can use hypochlorite. So hypochlorite, so there is no problem of toxic release. So, but it is a costlier process. So your manufacturing cost, production cost will increase. So depending on the thing, suppose you are unable to maintain it, so you have to go for a process of different nature. Then the very important factor coming to nowadays is hazard identification. What is hazard? Anything which has got a potential to cause harm is hazard. Suppose there is a rotating part. So it is a hazard. Why? Suppose by chance your hand will come in contact with the rotating part. So definitely there will be a cut of your hand, the hand, the amputation cases will come. So we must, in an industry while working, we must apply our head that what can go wrong. This is the situation. If the persons are working, is there any chance of cut injury? Is there any chance of slip? Is there any chance of fall? Is there any chance of explosion or fire? Whether is there any chance of electrocution? If we consider each and every part minutely, then definitely we can identify the hazards. And if hazards are identified, then we can definitely rectify it. After identification of the hazard, there should be a risk assessment. Even if we are getting 10 hazards, so everything has got a potential to cause harm. But if you assess it, you will find that all hazards are not having the same vulnerability. One is having more vulnerability, one is less. So accordingly, if you assess, you can give 1, 2, 3, 4, 10. So the 10 means less risk. 1 is high risk. So you can divide the entire hazards into a category. 1 is a high risk injury, 1 is a moderate risk injury, 1 is a low risk injury. So now the high risk injury are to be attended at the earliest, even the same day. But low risk, you can take time, because it is practically not possible for a management to address all hazards to identify or to rectify all hazards overnight, because it is not only cost effective, it also requires people to work in. So that's why risk assessment is also a very important part. So all engineering brands must, while reading all these things, once we go to the factory, we must apply all the things. Then development of infrastructure and preparation of emergency plan. These emergency development of infrastructure, if we understand that this is the risk is there, then how can we develop the our infrastructure? Suppose there is a chance of fall, a person is working at a height. Now you have to maintain it. The place is such that the chance of fall is arrested. Now for that, suppose a simple staircase is there, a person is going to the height, so there is a chance of fall. If you can make a good platform, maybe some platform with a, there are elevators like things, the edge hole, the platform will go out. Like you can see the electric bulbs in the street light. Earlier the concept was people are going with the help of a ladder and many people were falling. But now even vehicles are there, and the person will sit on the elevated ladder, and the ladder with a platform will gradually, it will raise up. So there is no problem. So this is development of infrastructure. So all these things are also required to be worked out. So now coming to the prevention. Prevention means a safer technology. I have already discussed that chlorine was used. Now we are using hypochlorite. So hypochlorite is a support technology. Adaptation of integrated safety system. Adaptation of integrated safety system are basically of two types. One is management with the while working with people, and management while working with the machine. Suppose a integrated method is there. Suppose a rotating part is there. It has got a, now suppose guard. Now while maintenance, the guard was removed and maintenance was done, and people forgot to put the guard again back to the same place. Now, if it is an integrated system or interlocking arrangement is there, now the machine will not operate unless it is closed, just like in a lift. If your doors is not closed, the lift will not operate. But suppose that system is not there and lift will start operating even if it is open. Definitely it will lead to problem, emergency. So integrated. And in many other systems, the human value of integrated system means a job work permit will be issued. Somebody will inspect it, somebody will certify it, and they will see whether personal property equipments are used or not. Then these are the adaptation of integrated safety system, these are required to be done. Then integrity of equipment, elimination of human error, emphasis on periodical safety audit, and practicing on on-site, off-site emergency plans, and periodical testing, etc. All these things you must also look into. Now preparedness. I have already discussed the on-site and off-site emergency plan. On-site means if an emergency, that fire, toxic release or explosion which can be contained within the factory premises is on-site. If it goes beyond the factory premises, that is off-site. So for that we have must educate the people, we should give them training. We should develop their capacity, and we must update it also, knowledge sharing, establishment of MARG. MARG is Mutual Aid Response Group. Suppose more than one factories are in a industrial cluster. If you go to some industrial clusters, you will find many industries are in a one belt. Particularly suppose in Odisha, in Jajpur Industrial State, Jajpur Road, we are getting lot of industrial industries. In Paradeep, we are having lot of industries. So at that time, each and every industry, they are having their safety equipment. They are having their personal protective equipment. They are having their fire prevention systems. So now the industries can have mutual agreement with each other. In case of a problem of one factory, the other factory will help. So that will also definitely improve. Then awareness of the community. Then effective coordination among different agencies. Different agency means fire, maybe your NDRF, order of team, police, then pollution control board, or maybe some other, if you in the department also, if you want to see the pump house operator, so whether the water is there in the tank or not, then the fire people, the fire tender operator, all the things. So there must be a good coordination with people. Then only that is called preparedness. then the response. So whenever suppose there is an emergency situation, alertness is important. You must detect it that yes, some leakage. There are even now online monitoring systems are there. Suppose ammonia sensors are there, chlorine sensors are there. It is being fixed to the storage yards or in the pipeline. So when the PPM level goes beyond the permissible limit, it gives alarm. Even in your houses, they are now fitted with the sensors. Depending on the heat, suppose there is a fire or there is some the wire, electrical wire, so some because of short circuit, etc. So now before it catches fire, definitely some heat will be there. Now the sensors can now sense it and they will immediately start operating the sensor. So now there will be either the water will sprinkle, etc. So this is what is called AlertNet. That sort of system we have to see. Then commission of SOP, SAP operating procedure. Each machine, now the manufacturer, they give a SOP. SAP, what to, how effective will you do? Suppose you purchase a vehicle, the vehicle owner, the manufacturer will give you one SOP, a book. In the book, everything is written. If there is start, no start, so you check 1, 2, 3, 4. If there is a this problem, you check 1, 2, 3, 4. These are nothing but SOP. Similarly, in each and every machine in a factory, the SOP are being given by the manufacturer. It is the responsibility of the engineers like you, who will be the future engineers, while going to a shop floor. You must adhere to these SOPs. And if SOPs are not there, suppose, then you must develop one. Then activation of the SOP, time management, clear communication, all the things will definitely take place. Some sort of, we want to stimulate your brain that these are also certain things which are although not in your syllabus or course, but these will be required once you become a full-fledged engineer and you start working in the shop floor. Then perceptions. Now, perceptions of individual, industry, society and government changes, individual to individual. So suppose a chemical factory, many people say nothing will happen. Some become very serious. Industry people, some industries are very, like in Tata Group of Industries, they are very serious on safety. Some other industries, they are not at all serious or less serious. Then society, in many areas society, there are some group of people, they are very sensitive. They always be very with their toes that we must do this. Suppose there is a problem, we'll do like this. But other people, they don't bother. Even in government organ, government, in many state governments, they are taking some actions well in advance. They are preparing the offsite emergency plan. They are making the offsite emergency drill. They are now making their fire people, making the NDRF people well assembled so that how to develop the issues. Now, this is the perception of industry. Here's the control. If at all there is a problem, so we must see that the hazard is to be eliminated. Now, suppose we are having a ceiling fan. I am giving one example. Ceiling fan, and it is giving noise. So our hazard is the noise. Now, how can we do it? We can eliminate it. How can we eliminate? Now, suppose we make a good balancing or greasing of the material or the fan, then definitely the noise will be reduced. So the hazard is eliminated by this. Second, suppose substitution. Now what we can do, suppose nothing is happening, we'll replace it by another. Third is the engineering control. What is engineering control? If anybody of you have gone to a steel plant, if you are going to a hot rolling mill, you will find the materials are being heated to up to 1000 degree centigrade. That is, we say the recrystallization temperature. If the melting temperature of iron is 1539 degree centigrade, the recrystallization temperature will be around 750 like this. So the material in hot rolling mill passes through at 950 to 1000 degree centigrade. Now, it is very difficult for an operator to work in that hot atmosphere for 8 hours. So what is being done, engineering control? Now the operators are given some glass room and inside there is AC so that the vision is intact. They can see the material, but they are well inside. Outside is hot, inside is cool. This is engineering. So isolate people from hazard. So hazard is the heat and the person is isolated from the heat by giving an effective barrier of a glass house. Now administrative control, many people, they just don't try to avoid the safety rules, etc. administrative control will be there, some punishment, some instruction, some warning to the people. Then personal property equipment. Personal property equipment, these helmets, shoes, etc. This will also help people. So this is the system. And the elimination is the most effective. And PP is the last resort. Many times people say, he is not using helmet. Helmet, you see, if any organization is asking people to use helmet, you can see that their safety system is not very strong. If a safety system is strong, is not, your head will be well protected inside the factory. Now, this is hazard versus risk. I have already discussed with this with some small examples. So, before, there are few other slides. So, may I know how much more time I am having? Or I am having time? Excuse me? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Can I know how much more time I am having?
Actually, sir, the time is 6 to 7, but if you want, you can still continue.
No. Now, what is the time actually?
Sir, it's 7 p.m.
7 p.m. Okay. So, another 10 minutes, I hope I must be allowed. Okay?
Yes, sir. Sure. Not a problem.
Okay. Thank you. See, I am giving you one theory, a cockroach theory. Just I am reading it. At a restaurant, a cockroach sat on a lady. She started screaming and jumped out of fear to get rid of the cockroach. The lady managed to push the cockroach away, but it landed on another lady. Now it was the turn of the other lady in the group to continue the drama. In the reply of throwing, in the relay of throwing, the cockroach next fell upon the waiter. The waiter stood firm, composed himself, and observed the behavior of the cockroach. When he was confident enough, he grabbed it with his fingers and threw it out of the restaurant. Now the point is, was the cockroach responsible for their histrionic behavior? The answer is no. If so, then why was the waiter not disturbed? He handled it without any chaos. So it is not the cockroach, but their inability to handle the disturbance caused by the cockroach that disturbs the ladies. It is now the traffic, it is not the traffic jams on the road that disturbs us, but our inability to handle the disturbance caused by the traffic jam that disturbs us. So the lesson learnt is, we should not react in life, we should always respond. That is the basic philosophy of emergency preparedness. Now suppose you are working in a factory. Now chlorine started leaking. So being a good engineer, you should not react, you should respond to the system. That is what the disaster management is. Now there are certain challenges of disaster management. We have to prepare the database on hazardous chemical. We have to make some other systems, even mobile hospitals. So just I was telling you, now suppose there is an accident in a factory and there is a burn injury. Now, burn injury is required to be addressed very fast. Now, what happens? Now, the patient is transferred from factory to hospital. It takes 30 minutes. Now, suppose a mobile hospital means a mobile van with all facilities available. Now, once you get the call, now the mobile hospital or van can reach to the site. And in the process, now the time you take to rescue the person, now the mobile hospital is well in the factory. So immediate treatment can be done. So that is now some of the challenges which are required to be addressed. So other challenges, commissioning, decommissioning plans, industrial pocket-wise hazard analysis, GIS-based emergency planning, safety audit, mutual aid response I have discussed. So these are certain things you have to see for the industrial disasters. So last two slides. Now, Vision Zero fundamental principle, this is a globe-wise concept. In the globe-wise, what is Vision Zero? Vision Zero does not mean that we want to make your vision zero. Vision Zero means you make your vision that zero accident is possible. Many times in many industry, people say, how can you make accident zero? But now the global tendency, the World Health Organization, the ILO, they say, yes, Vision Zero is possible. And how can you do it? There are four fundamental principles. Everything you have to understand that life is not negotiable. Human beings are fallible. Means human being will definitely make mistakes. So once you are making any system or any machine operation, the law says, the law of the land in India says that your processes should be foolproof. Fool, the spelling is not F-U-L-L. Spelling is F-O-O-L, means a person without knowledge is a fool. So foolproof, even a fool will also work. There will be no problem. That should be the concept. Then tolerable limits are set by physical and mental endurance of human beings. And human beings have a right to be safe and healthy work environment. This is called Vision Zero. And these are the chemical handles in our. There are some of the chemical accidents that have taken place recently, like Stirling gas boiler explosion. These are the Vizag gas leakage disaster. Why it happened? What are the risk factors? What are the lessons learned? I hope if anybody is further interested can go through this, read this also, and can give me questions later on also, no problem, because of time, etc. So these are things. Now you can think of a chemical situation. I am giving you one example. Suppose there is a LPG bottling plant, and in the plant when there will be a leakage of chlorine, now suppose this circle is the area it is going to be affected. Now you have to now see there is a police station, now there is a school. So these are the roads, these are the train lines, this is a river, and there are many temples, some hospitals, all the things are available. Now we have to take care of everything. So for that, lot of strategy and planning is required to be done. Now another thing, suppose there are two districts and having two district collectors. Now it can so happen the leakage in one factory, one district, but because of the leakage, now it will now go, suppose 5 kilometers on the there, so it will enter into the other district. So district B is not aware of the hazard, and it has the industry within the district B has not caused the problem, but the problem in district A is giving a effect in district B. For that also we should be careful. These things can also happen. So I am giving you in IPCO Paradip. Now there are certain ammonia, it can go up to 7.5 kilometer. You can think of. So it can also go to 7.5 kilometer. So ammonia tank, it can go up to 20 kilometers. So this is the extent of problem it can create. So it is very difficult that we will allow a chemical accident to come in. So a lot of precautions are to be taken. So this is a dispersion modeling it looks like. Suppose this is at zero. Zero is the leakage point. Now, if it starts moving, then what will happen? It can travel up to, suppose, 1.8 kilometers. Now, you can say gradually it increases. But the other areas, now, because the wind direction is here, suppose wind direction is here, now this core will be like this. So, only this area people will be affected. So, it is because of the technology, by using this, we can identify that the people within these range are definitely vulnerable. So like this, so these are the certain things. We can take a lot of precautionary measures like this. So coming to the end of my slide, so three things I want to say. The second chances are rare. Use your first wisely and learn from own mistakes. That proverb is now outdated. Now we have to learn from others' mistakes. Suppose there is an accident in one factory. So we must learn what happened in the other factory, and we will try to implement in our factory. If we don't do it, then we will allow the same accident to happen in our factory and cause human life. So that is something we can say a negligence. So learn from others' mistake, and failure to prepare is preparing to fail. Thank you very much. So now I can ask you, if you can, any one, two questions, if you want to ask also, I am ready. Or you can give me mail, I will reply. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah.
If anyone is having any queries, you can either write in the chat box or just unmute yourself and ask.
So sir, I have one question. Actually, I have two questions.
Yes.
So the first one is, are the people who are not directly exposed to the shop floor also in risk of some chemical hazards, like the administrative workers or IT workers?
100%, 100%, sir. The point of interest is the engineering principle says, if any industry is using chemicals, it should be segregated to one of the corner of the factory, of a building also, and it should be well isolated. Only the person who are required to operate with the chemicals will be allowed to go with adequate precautionary measures. That is number one. So that other people will not come in contact with the things. Number two, now suppose there is a leakage, it has got its range, depending on the dispersion modeling, that how far it will travel. So the distance the chemical will travel, the people who are exposed to it will be definitely affected by it. So all the people are required as per the emergency plan, there will be a siren, and all the people, we advise them to immediately rush to the assembly point. So 2-3 assembly points are well located inside the factory, which are the safest place, and the chemicals cannot reach there through dispersion. So that is the principle. This is education is given to the people through mock drills, through real cells, that only the person who are going to tackle the disaster must rush to the site to handle it. Others who have got no business must rush to the safe zone, to the assembly point. Now coming to the, in a disaster in a larger magnitude, once it crossed beyond the boundary of the factory, now the people are also going to be affected. Now at that time, under the statutory provision of law, it is the responsibility of the management of each factory. They should make awareness training program in the vicinity of the factories, so that people will be educated that our factory is having such chemical, there is chance of leakage, there is chance of explosion, even if best of the care is being taken. Suppose these things happen and there is a leakage, we will definitely give the warning or alarm signal, and the alarm signal will also vary. For fire, the alarm signal is different. For explosion, the alarm signal is different. For toxic release, the alarm signal is different. Now, if the people can understand that PPL is the factory where ammonia is being stored and the alarm signal is for a gas leakage, they will understand that ammonia has started leaking. Now, what they will do? Now, the way they are being trained, accordingly they will do. They will start moving away from the wind direction and they will move. So, if a chemical is coming in the atmosphere and it reaches within the vicinity of the people, whether they are inside the factory or whether they are outside the factory, if they are exposed to chemical, they are under vulnerable zone. And precautionary measures is required to be taken. That is the reason why 10,000 people in methyl isocyanide, union carbide, and all the people are outside the factory and they were exposed. Thank you. Anything else, sir?
Sir, one more question, sir.
Yeah.
So you talked about dispersion modeling, where you said that the size of the leak is an important variable.
Correct.
So, sir, after the disaster has happened, how do engineers or scientists calculate the size of the leak?
You see, that is what we do is, dispersion modeling is done not at the time of leakage. Dispersion modeling is done depending on the conditions which may take place. So we will consider that there will be a leakage. Let the leakage diameter is this. Then how much will come? Then what is the distance will travel? If the diameter is little more, how much distance it will come? If the diameter is little still more, how much it will come? And the worst scenario, now suppose such leakages have taken place all over the world, the statistics is taken. Now we can consider that the leakage can go up to this is the maximum. So for that, what is the maximum distance it will travel? So that is our actually, we have to plan in advance so that we can understand that it can travel up to this distance, and the people within that distance now will be activated. We'll consider them that they are in the vulnerable zone, and all sort of training, preparedness, etc. will work out. So it is simply a method which gives us a prior, the planning stage, so that we can consider maybe the worst possible conditions. So the term used here is the worst possible condition. This may not happen in practice, but if we are prepared for the worst, definitely other things we can handle. So many times, even in some week, we consider a catastrophic failure. That suppose the total collapsed, a hot and spare collapsed. So in that case, what is the maximum extent of injury, I mean, travel distance? So accordingly, you will get prepared. So if you are prepared for the worst, other things were well within your limit, so you can handle it with that. So that is how the plannings are made. And if you have run a dispersion modeling software, there are a lot of parameters. It will come into action, whether it is vertical, whether it is horizontal, whether it is under the ground, whether it is on the ground, whether it is above the ground, what is the quantity, what is the toxicity, what is the temperature. So depending on the factors, so definitely the dispersion modeling graph, etc., will definitely vary. Anything, sir?
Sir, we have one question in the chat box. I shall read it out for you. So the question is, well, last week I read in the Hindu editorial that every year more than 3 million people migrate. The reason behind this is mainly the fear of natural disasters. So, sir, can you explain us why government is not able to ensure people that they are safe? And if they are not safe, then why government is not taking steps to migrate them from coastal areas?
You see, migration is a system which has got a right for the people to migrate. Suppose I am reading engineering and I am from, suppose, Assam or maybe from Meghalaya. If I get a job in Delhi, so definitely I will go. That is also called migration. But now migrations are basically of two types. If a person is forced to migrate because of his financial condition, if he doesn't move out from his own district or home state, then he cannot earn his livelihood. Now it is a matter of concern. So there are a lot of systems taken up by central government and the individual state governments to create job for the people so that people will not go to outside. But it is not mandatory under the purview or ambit of law that the workers will be denied to migrate. Because if somebody is getting higher wage in the outside, so he has got a right to migrate. But the job of government is to see that even if there is a migration, people must save. So now lot of systems government of India has already taken up. We are having one nation, one ration card. We are having all systems, suppose ESI, Provident Fund, etc., whatever facilities there, now it has become online, people can go. We are having the housing board system for the migrant labor. So these migrant problems definitely have encountered everywhere, not only in India, all countries all over the world having the problem. And it is because of some steps are being taken, at least people are safe, and overnight things, you cannot say that overnight things will improve, but slowly and steadily the conditions, if you were rightly seen in the newspaper, you must also rightly must have seen and go browse, and you will find that lot of measures have been taken by finance minister, government of India and the respective state government to see that the interest of the migrant laborers is being taken care of. And particularly coming to the point of suppose disaster, just like now COVID is a condition. Now there are a lot of things where people were not aware. Now even government of India, they were not aware that such quantity of oxygen cylinders will be required. Once it has happened, now it has been geared up. So it is, you cannot simply say that everything, once there is a problem, now we are ready to attend the problem. That is what is the concept of government. And our intention of the government for the zero casualty. Even the UN, even the World Health Organization, even the central government, even the state government, even the district administration or even the local administration, they are going with a very basic concept of vision zero, means zero casualty. With that they are aiming. That's why I have rightly told during 1999 super cyclone in Odisha, more than 10,000 people died, but it is because of the actions day by day. From 99 to 2020, the rate was 63. 63, we are not happy. Our interest was zero. But over above, what happens many times, people, they don't abide the rules, regulations. They don't take care of they don't listen to these things. Out of the system, they immediately go, come out from the house, do a lot of things contrary to the system. So that's why there is some problem. But slowly and steadily, all the along with everything, the awareness program, a lot of technical measures, all things are being taken care. So slowly and slowly, absolute things overnight is practically not possible. But we have to see the progressive growth of a nation, the intention of the management, intention of the government. Intention of government is towards vision zero, zero casualty. That is, although it is in letter and spirit, it is there. In reality, we are unable to get it 100% because 100% efficiency is very difficult. Even a Carnot engine, which is having 100% efficiency, practically no engine nowadays in all our world is constructed, which is giving 100% efficiency. Anyway, thank you for considering that the administration will become a Carnot engine. It's a very good thing. We will definitely try to gear up. Thank you. Any other questions, sir?
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Now, I would like to request Professor Harish Chandra Das, sir, Dean Student Welfare, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Yeah, thank you, Manasi. Very good evening to one and all. And my dear students, my colleague, Dr. Dibyendu Adak, the Vice President of the Student Activity Center, Dr. Molay Kumar Pradhan, the Speaker of the Evening, the participant from the outside the Institute, and other ladies and gentlemen. It is my proud and privilege to welcome you all, and also particularly Dr. Molay Kumar Pradhan, the General Manager, Odisha State Disaster Management, to this function, to this Cognizia 21, which is annual technical festival of National Institute of Technology, Meghalaya. Dr. Pradhan was giving a very long talk on the disaster management. He is having a lot of experience in managing different types of the disasters. He was expressing the disaster in chemical, but he is having, I know him personally, he is having a lot of experience in different type of disasters, starting from the structural disaster, electrical disaster, fire disaster, chemical disasters. So in all type of disasters, he is having a lot of knowledge which helps him in the management, because he generally gives the advice to the industries that how to manage the disaster at the time of its occurrence from his vast experience. So what actually he was telling that any of you will join the industries, particularly the core industries, maybe the manufacturing industries, maybe the process industry, the safety is an important part. You should know about the details of the disasters and how to manage it. That is most important, because the life of a human being is very, very important. So any disasters, because some questioners were there and he was answering very nicely that any disaster, it should be beforehand, it should, the probable risk should be assessed in a quantification manner, that is called the quantitative risk assessment, from which the worst case scenario is to be calculated. You are showing the dispersion modeling from which the worst case scenario is calculated. And this worst case scenario is an instructive measure, is an advisory measure to the industries, and the workers are being advised to work with these instructive measures, so that chance of fatality is or casualty is very less. That is the most important part of the disaster management. So I am really thankful to Dr. Molay Kumar Pradhan for giving such a nice and informative presentation to all the students. Our students will get educated, and if somebody will join the core industries, disaster, I am telling you right now, and you will see the safety and disaster will be the one of the important point when you are entering to the industry. You must be safe before you are going to work. Thank you, Dr. Pradhan, for giving a nice presentation, and thank you, my dear students. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Professor Das. Thank you.
Now, last but not the least, I, on behalf of the entire Cognition team, sir, would like to thank Dr. Malay Kumar Pradhan, sir, for enlightening us with his knowledge and beautiful and sharing his very beautiful experiences. Thank you very much, sir, for taking out time from your busy schedule. And I'm pretty sure the precious knowledge that you have given us will definitely help our students in future. Thank you very much. Now we'll be ending the session.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.